We have the privilege and the honor of being the Salvation Army leaders in this community. We're so grateful for you being here this day. It has been our procedure through all that has taken place over the last several years that everything has been bathed in prayer. I am telling you, there has not been a phone call made. There has not been a letter written. There has not been an application sent. There has not been a meeting begun or end without prayer, and this day will be no different. I invite you and encourage you to pause just a moment as we lift up the name of our Heavenly Father. Let us pray. Loving Father, we acknowledge you as a great and mighty God. We acknowledge you as the gift of every good and perfect gift. Father, we acknowledge you as the one who is the holder of the past, the present, and the future. So, Father, we just simply give this day to you. Father, in the whole spectrum of time and space, this is a small moment, but it is a great moment in the impact that it can have in this community. So, Father, first, we pray your blessing. Second, I say thank you for all who have gathered here this day. Now, Father, come be our guest. This really is for you. We ask these things because we love you and only because we love you. In Christ's holy name, amen. Well, it's a great day for the city of Lakeland. It is a great day for this county. It's a great day for this community. It's a great day for the Salvation Army. And it's a great day for the thousands of people that we serve year-round right here in our community. I don't need to tell you that this is a fantastic community, but also there is need in this community. And we are honored to be able to share in reaching out to help folks who are in need. I thank you for being here today. A special thanks to all our guest speakers for the day. Thanks to our advisory board. Welcome for being here. Our staff who have just done a tremendous job helping put this event together. And members of our very core. Thank you so much to all of you for being here. And a special thanks for our friends and supporters of this day. Again, in another time, in another place, there was a prophet whose name was Jeremiah. He wrote this. It ended up being in a book. In fact, it was the 29th chapter of his book and the 11th verse. Before you leave this day, each of you will receive this. On one side is the shield of the Salvation Army. On the other side is the statement that drives us. I hate to call it a slogan, but it is a heart verse that we've taken on as our theme as we move into the future. Hear these words. It says, I know the plans that I have in mind for you, declares the Lord. They are plans for peace, not disaster. To give you a future filled with hope. You are part of that vision today. You are part of that future. You are part of that hope. I go to meetings all the time, and I leave that meeting and think, you know what, they just could have sent me an email on that. We have a wonderful, a special announcement to make, and it deserved more than just an email or a note sent to you. Our proceedings for the rest of this time is simple. We have 5 speakers lined up, and please understand they've all been mandated 3 to 5 minutes each, so you won't miss your lunch. And if we do, we're going to the mayor's house. And he's going to serve Publix deli. Untold hours go into any operation of this magnitude. Mountains of paperwork. But this is a joyous occasion because we jumped over lots of hurdles and crawled our way through many, many hoops. But this is a celebration, and I am so grateful that you are here. It is my distinct honor and pleasure to introduce to you, as they say, a gentleman that does not need an introduction, but a man who brings integrity and class to any event that he attends. It's my pleasure to present to you the mayor of our wonderful city, Mayor Gal Fields. Would you join us, please, sir?
Good morning. I was almost wondering who the captain was talking about, especially on that class part. I was asked to share a little bit about community and what that means, and I'm going to try to do that and honor my time restraint at the same time. I know Mayor Fletcher would be happy about that. When we look at community, at its basis, it's a commonality of people who have a common purpose, a common desire, and in some cases, common hopes. And they choose to commit to one another to work in a unified manner together. And that's what Lakeland really represents, and this community that's being birthed here today represents that as well. We see that there have been people who have come together who believe it is their purpose and working in a partnership with their Lord to be a blessing to those who are less fortunate and need a helping hand to get reestablished again. And that's what this community represents. And to me, Lakeland is one of the most giving and generous communities, I wouldn't just say in the country, but I will go and be a little braggadocious and say in the world. And this, in the birthing of this community within the community of Lakeland is an example of that. Because of the partnerships that exist in this entire community, we're able to do things that it takes cities much larger than us to be able to accomplish and pull off, and that's part of what makes Lakeland so special. And I want to say thank you to the captain and to his team for hanging in there when we weren't quite sure if we were going to get this community birthed, and when things were looking a little shaky as one neighborhood decided they didn't want it close to them versus another. And I just want to say thank you for hanging in there and maintaining that commitment. And by you doing so, you have brought others into this partnership, and it is going to be a true blessing, not only to our service to the Lord, but also to his children that he has asked us to reach out to and help in their time of need. And with that, Captain, I think I kept it under 3 minutes, and we'll leave 2 extra for somebody else. But I cannot say thank you enough to everyone that's been involved in bringing about this new community and birthing it in the way that you have. God bless you all, and we look forward to exciting things from the Army.
Good morning. I'm Jeff Cox, and I've been involved in this project for 8 or 10 years. And it's just a phenomenal pleasure to be able to be involved in something of this magnitude that is so neat and to have been supported by so many good friends. 8 years ago, the United Way asked the volunteer organizations in the community to look and see where we might have redundant services being provided. The Army, the Salvation Army Board appointed a strategic group. And we looked at what we were providing as ministries and what we're already taking care of and what maybe there was too much of. And one of the things that was clear was the feeding ministries downtown were more than adequately served. You could easily receive 5-6 meals a day if you were homeless and in need of a meal. Our group studied that, and we looked at what we were doing very well and what was perhaps unique to our ministries. And we looked at our transitional living, where you come into our program and you agree to stay for 2 years. During that 2 years, you're under a very high degree of accountability, but we teach you how to save, how to organize, how to manage your programs. We provide health care. An adult in the family has to have a job. But we kind of retrain folks so that they can enter society again and transition into a meaningful life. And our success rate is well over 80%. So it's a program that works and is very successful. Looking at that and looking at the desire to expand that ministry, we said we're not going to be able to do that where we are in Massachusetts Avenue. We just don't have the square footage. So we began visioning as to where we would go and what we would do. And my big theme is hope. Because early in our program, just two years into it, we met with a benefactor family, and they so graciously helped us, and they were the first evidence of this new hope. They said, you know what, we share your vision and we're going to help you. And it gave us all hope that we could accomplish this mission, and it is a big mission. So what are we going to do? On our property in Massachusetts Avenue, we have an emergency care facility that takes care of up to 15 families. If you lose your home, you're foreclosed on, or something happens, you can come to our emergency shelter and we'll take care of you for a month or two and help kind of catch you before you fall off the cliff, and perhaps you can get reorganized and reestablished. We also have 12 units of transitional living, which is this program that's a two-year program where we really help you get on a solid, sustainable path. Because of the requirements of our transitional living, we provide a healthcare, a child care system called HALO, where we train children, look after them, and give them a place to go while the adult member in the transitional living has a job, so that we facilitate that. At that ministry, we're providing feeding. What we're going to do here is we're going to close Massachusetts Avenue and leave only our SHIELD operation, which is an intake operation and kind of a reference place. If you're a disabled veteran or a veteran and you lost your way and perhaps had a traumatic experience and lost your identity and one thing or another, we have a gentleman there that will work with you and with the Department of Defense, and we will reestablish your identity so that you can get those benefits that you so richly deserve as a veteran that served our country. We also provide rent relief, and they will refer you to other service providers in the community. That will remain downtown. But our primary ministry of emergency care and transitional living and HALO is going to move to this site, and we're going to expand the transitional living from 12 units to 21 to begin with, and the emergency care from 15 units to 20 units. The HALO facility we are going to replace here so that we have the entire community. We are also going to build, the Salvation Army, if you've ever seen hurricane relief, the first thing you see is the shield. Well, you have to store all that equipment somewhere, and we're going to build a warehouse out here to store it so that it's properly looked after. We're going to provide laundry facilities. We're going to put a gymnasium out here so that the children will have a place to exercise, and that will be used by the community. So the expansion of this thing is we've had such wonderful hope given to us. But my favorite term in all the world is grace. But my favorite motivating term is hope, because when you're down and something's going against you, sometimes somebody has to just grab you by the hand and say, come on, let me help you. And if you can take a person that's down and you can give them hope, they can accomplish anything they want to do, particularly if you compassionately care for them as the Army does. So this hope is such an important thing to our community, to the mission of the Salvation Army. I thank all of you for coming, and I look forward to us accomplishing this broad vision as we expand the Army and this wonderful ministry they provide. Thank you.
Jeff, thank you, and thank you for all you're doing. Thank all of you for being here. I'm Bill Vass. I am the current chair of our local advisory board. Which is why I guess I get the privilege that I get today. Jeff presented the community of hope. I get to tell you how it's going to be named. So if we could unveil what we need to unveil here. This will be, and we're proud to present, the George W. Jenkins Community of Hope. Now, I get to say a couple of things about that, which is nearly impossible in 3 minutes, but I'm going to hustle, and I've picked a couple. First, just let me tell you, when I get on the list of the things that I am thankful to God for, but way up near the top of the list, a couple of them are the Salvation Army and just being able to be associated with the Army and its work over a number of years. But another one is to be able to live where George Jenkins lived. I mean, it is a remarkable privilege that just affects everyone that I know. So a couple of thoughts about that that came to me I want to share with you of things that I think make this naming so appropriate, because they really are things that are in common between Mr. George and the Salvation Army. If I were to summarize it, I would simply say that both of them have done things the right way. Salvation Army, that is clearly the case. Working with the Army, the quality of the work, the care, the stewardship, the selflessness of the work, and the magnificent effectiveness of the work, as Jeff was referring to. The Salvation Army has done things in an excellent way. Those of you who knew Mr. George, all of you know Publix, know that that is the case with him. I came to Lakeland for two reasons. One of them is that Barney Barnett called me and offered me a job. That was very important. But the other was that I had worked as an auditor with a public accounting firm and had audited Publix for 3 years, and I had known Mr. George. I'd met him, talked to him. But more than that, I'd studied him as I studied business people at that time, and I knew a lot about the unique genius of that man. And I learned a lot more working around him day to day. Very special, dedicated to excellence, produced a business that prospered based on that dedication, but he was committed that that not be a prosperity just for him, but rather everyone around him benefited, whether they were suppliers, whether they were the people who worked in the company, whether they were customers of the company. Everyone's life became better, and in particular, the communities that Publix served became better. He was dedicated to that, dedicated to giving back, as he would say. And his commitment there went in particular to young people, the kind of people that will be in the families that are served here, and giving them that hope and also giving them guidance. And he supported those things throughout his life, and he saw it as his responsibility to give those people the kind of hope that Jeff talked about. And that makes this very appropriate. The other thing that struck me was I had the privilege a few weeks ago of listening to the children of the family being interviewed for a documentary being done on the life of Mr. George. And one of the things that dawned on me as I was listening to them, they were talking about the wisdom that he served the family with, that he taught the children. And I would listen to that, and the wisdom, basically these phrases that he would use were biblical phrases. I mean, such as, to whom much is given of him will much be required, in the passage from Luke 12, I think it is. And at any rate, what you realized is these things which were taught to him by his mother were things he believed and became integral in his life and reflected in the philanthropy that he showed. And it made me think, as I thought about that, that one of the things he has in common with the Salvation Army is they both have Methodist roots. He had his mother, and of course the Salvation Army came out of that background. And it's had a tremendous effect on both of them. And if you have Methodist roots, that means somehow in your DNA there is Wesley. Not Wesley Barnett, although we're delighted he's here, but John Wesley. And it reminded me of his reasonably famous motto. It ought to be more famous. I had to write it down. And let me read it to you. What the motto says is, "Do all the good you can," John Wesley wrote, "by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as you ever can." Now, I don't know an organization that represents that motto better than the Salvation Army, and I do not know an individual in the free enterprise system who represented that motto better than George Jenkins. He did the work in the free enterprise system right. He did it in a way that we need examples of in our time, and we need people to know that there are people who are engaged in the free enterprise system in that way. So I can't tell you how delighted I am that we have the privilege to name this place for him for lots of reasons, in addition to the way that he and his family have supported the Salvation Army. It is a wonderful privilege, and I'm just very thankful both for the Army and for living where Mr. George lived. That having been said, I get to introduce our co-chair of the campaign, who is, Barney, I think we're getting close to 40 years now. I went back to track it when I first came to Publix to audit. Time flies when you're having fun. And my life has been a lot more fun because of knowing you. I think you and my wife have been dedicated to seeing that there is some fun in my life. I tend to be an overly serious person about way too many things. But nonetheless, it's been a privilege and a pleasure to have this friendship with Barney. I would say, I don't know anyone other than perhaps your wife that I have known who have been as dedicated to the good of this community as you two. And I can't think of a better person to represent what we're trying to do here in this campaign to build this George W. Jenkins Community of Hope than Barney Barnett. So Barney, come on up.
Good morning, it's a beautiful day. I've always told myself there's one thing you don't want to do, and that's follow Bill Bass. But I've got to do that today. I've been in Lakeland most of my life, and my father was from Lakeland, and we moved back here when I was 6 after World War II. And it's been a great place to live, and we've seen a great things happen in this great community. And so I'm here to tell you a few things about George Jenkins that Bill's already told you, so I'm going to repeat what Bill said. But I've got notes, so I don't want to mess it up. Dudley Borders used to call me about every day. I don't know if any of you knew Dudley, but Dudley was in the produce business. And he would call me almost daily and say, "Hey, son-in-law, how's it doing?" I said, "Well, Dudley, I can tell you one thing. It's great being Mr. Jenkins' son-in-law. There's hardly anything better than being George Jenkins' son-in-law, because he was a great guy. George Jenkins was truly a great American. He was the founder and the first leader of our great company, Publix. He continued to lead us until his stroke in 89, and then that's when 5 of us, including Bill and myself, tried to take over the company and see if we could keep it running straight, because the thing you always heard for years at Publix was, "My goodness, what's going to happen when Mr. George is no longer with us?" But we worked it out, and Publix has continued to grow, and we've had great leadership, and we have his great legacy to depend on. Mr. George was a real people person. He loved his customers, he loved his associates, he even loved his vendors, really loved his vendors. He had a party for them every year until we started opening on Sundays, and we didn't have a day to have the party. So the fact of the matter, he loved everybody. But most of all, he loved his family and he loved this community. He was a generous man. Fortunately for us, 1966 when he started the foundation? He started his private foundation, known then as the George W. Jenkins Foundation. Today it's known as Public Supermarkets Charities. And that great organization is headed up by his lovely daughter and my wife, Carol. We have several people here today connected to Public Supermarkets Charities, and they are Kelly Williams Puccio, Suzanne Redavid, and Tracy Carter. I don't think there's anybody else, but y'all stand up so we can see who y'all are. Many of you knew Sharon Miller, and Sharon unfortunately had a stroke, but we were fortunate to find Kelly, a 30-year employee, or maybe less than that, maybe a 10-year employee of Publix. to step in to take Sharon's place, and she's doing a wonderful job. George Jenkins supported the Salvation Army prior to his death, and we continue to do so through Public Supermarkets Charities. We also continue his legacy with United Way giving. And I thought I saw Terry Worthington here somewhere. There's Terry. Hi, Terry. How you doing? And I believe, if I'm correct, the United Way of Central Florida donated $500,000 to Salvation Army this past year in our area, Polk and Highlands and County, right? The Army is also supported well by many of the United Ways. In fact, I think most United Ways support the Salvation Army, don't they, Terry? But we didn't do that research. Tracy didn't have time. She was talking to many people on the telephone. Probably most important, we continue his legacy of allowing kettle drives outside public stores. Last Christmas season, over $4 million was raised at our Publix locations in Florida. That's in Florida. That's pretty special. I am happy that Wesley's here to see this dedication. Wesley grew up in Lakeland, and Wesley has become a good member, a great member, I think, of the Lakeland community. And we're hopeful that Wesley will follow the legacy of Carol and his grandparents. He had one rich grandparent, and he had one set of rich grandparents, one set of poor grandparents, but they were all generous people. And so we're happy that Wesley will be here to be a part of this great community. So in closing, George Jenkins was a great man, and he would be very proud to know his name is attached to this fabulous community of hope. So thank y'all for thinking about doing this, Bill, Jeff, and I think it's more than appropriate to have Mr. George Jenkins' name. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Barnett. I was thinking while you were speaking, I sure like that green jacket. I have a tunic that'll fit you. I can have that specially made just right away. Thank you so much, sir, and thank you for the family. I'm so grateful for that. Now it's my privilege to introduce to you my boss. This is a gentleman I'm very fond of. He is the CEO, we call him the Divisional Commander of the Salvation Army for the whole state of Florida. And he also has some unique and interesting ties to this very community. And I've asked Colonel Vern Jewett if he would come and close our proceedings today with some closing remarks as well as a prayer of blessing and thanksgiving. Let me remind you of the card that I want you to take with you as a reminder of this day, as a reminder of the future, a prayer card. And just right after Colonel Jewett has our prayer, our closing will be, we're going to sing the doxology. I don't know why that came to me, but it was something that I thought would be a wonderful, unifying way to close our day. Once again, thank you so much for being here. Colonel Jewett, would you please come and grace us?
What a wonderful day. What a wonderful privilege for me to be here. And to be speaker 5 out of 5, there's not a lot left unique for me to say, but I certainly want to say just a few things. First of all, it's great to see friends and partners in mission and ministry and community. We had the privilege of serving here, our family, from 1988 to 1995. And I met Mr. George and developed a wonderful and profound respect for this community. Our children went to schools here, and so part of our heart is here, and it is a very special day for me to be able to be here with you. And I would say that having had the privilege of living around the country, Mayor, I agree with you. Having the privilege of traveling a little bit around the world, I don't know that I've ever been part of a community that expresses the sense of community and embraces each other and does what we in the Salvation Army think is profoundly important, that is, treat those who are marginalized and oppressed and forgotten and hurting with love and care. And it was a wonderful experience for us and to watch our children grow up here in Lakeland. So I echo everything that has been said about this wonderful community. The Salvation Army is 147 years old and now is in 124 countries around the world. One of the questions we like to ask ourselves, those of us in the Salvation Army, is what would our founder, William Booth, think of what we're doing today? And there is not a doubt in my mind that he would look at this Community of Hope project and say that is the perfect expression of what God has called us to be part of, reaching our heart to God with our hand out to man in compassionate, loving care and service. We were fortunate to be here when some of the programs that will reside here on this campus were begun. And I was very caught, Jeff. You really spoke my notes very, very beautifully, and I thank you for that, because it's worth reinforcing. This theme, A Future Filled with Hope, has captivated me, because there are incredible challenges in every community. And when we address things, and there's a way in which all of the challenges that I'm speaking of will be addressed here on this campus. Lack of sanitation, affordable housing, adequate medical care, infant mortality, all the things that can take a community take some in it and separate them and marginalize them. When you look at all of those things, I think there's a common factor that is the greatest tragedy of all, and that is a poverty of spirit, where you see there's not a heartbeat of hope. That's the greatest tragedy of all. And to have this project and community entitled the Community of Hope and partnered with the community and all of you and with the Public's family and Mr. Jenkins is just one of the most exciting things that I can imagine. And I want to close by reminding us about grace. It struck me recently, I was singing with a large number of people at a civic event. We were singing, "Oh, Beautiful for Spacious Skies, for Amber Waves of Grain." I'm a Nebraska boy. I can envision those amber waves of grain. "Purple Mountain Majesties above the fruited plain." America, America, God shed His grace on thee. And it struck me in a new way. I've been thinking about it for months. How does God do that? How does God shed His grace, His undeserved favor upon us? And He does that when partnerships and commitments and projects and communities like this seek to serve everyone in the community and seek to do it with a wonderful awareness of His blessing and His name. So I want to say congratulations. We are with you. We are partners with you. This will be the largest project the Salvation Army has undertaken in the state of Florida when it is completed. And it is a joy for us to be part of that. And I want to invite you to share in a prayer and a blessing upon all that will take place in the future right where we sit and stand today. So would you join me in prayer? Our gracious Heavenly Father, our hearts are moved and encouraged deeply at all that we see and hear this day. I want to thank You for everyone who is here and all those who are part of this moment throughout this community. I would ask and seek Your continued blessing upon this community and upon those who seek to serve you and live with an awareness of a future filled with hope. We ask that you would be part of this project as you have been to this point, from this point on, that your hand would guide the architect, the contractor, the fundraising, the project, so that we can serve people in your name with compassion, love, and grace. And now we ask your continued blessing upon everyone here. And we do this in your name with grateful hearts. Amen. God bless you.
And I add my words of thanks to you for being here this day. As our benediction response, I invite you to stand, and we're going to sing together, making a joyful noise, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Would you join me, please? Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Now go in peace, go in grace, and go with a future filled with hope. God bless you. Thank you.